está bien barreco.
Let's walk through this cladding detail, which is a masonry product on what is an expanded version of a rain screen on this house. But I want to start by bringing it back to the basics. We have a 2x6 wall, which is pretty typical here in Boston, Massachusetts, half inch sheathing, and then our SIGA, which is our WRB, our weather resistant barrier. So this is what you typically see on a home. Everything outboard of that is, I guess, what you would consider to be different. So I brought Vincent, who is the architect on this project. Vincent, I want you to help walk through what we got going on outside of our WRB layer. What is this expanded rain screen detail that we have here?
Yeah, Nick, this assembly is essentially a deeper, heavier insulated exterior rain screen. So it's similar in the nature performance to installing cedar over a cedar breather air cavity behind it, or a mesh that allows for drying behind that cedar. But in this case, it's scaled up. And so you could imagine doing half inch vertical strapping if you were running a horizontal wood cedar board. But the rain screen that you see here is one by vertical and horizontal strapping to carry the weight of masonry cover brick. And so the idea with this build is inspired by some of the masonry buildings and brick buildings that you see in New England, architecturally in terms of form relating to a kind of heavy cedar shake geometry. So this rain screen in terms of performance is allowing for 5 inches of exterior rock wool, a generous air cavity that will be sealed at the top and bottom with a stainless mesh to prevent bugs and critters from getting in, but will allow this to dry.
Let's start with the insulation. It's a rock wool product, mineral wool product. It is not a cavity bat insulation. That's what is, I think, sometimes confused amongst people is like, I thought it's fluffy. This is their semi-rigid insulation, so it's a comfort board 110. And you can see that we have some screws here. This is temporarily holding it onto our sheathing. On top of that, we have these 2x4s on the flat, and we're using these 10-inch screws. And this 10-inch screw actually goes through our 2x4 all the way back and has to hit our stud. One of the questions that came up is that, well, that screw protruding out like that, it's a lot of shear, you know, on that screw, a lot of bending force on that. Number one, you have them every 12 inches. So to bend multiple screws like that would be very difficult. But on top of that, when you're compressing, which you're not compressing much, but when you're compressing against the rock wool comfort board, you're actually creating a really rigid structure, which then supports the weight of that.
In this case, the rock wool is sufficient because of the spacing of the strapping and the way these screws are engineered. They're actually engineered to go in the structural layer that holds the vertical coursing to the studs is at a slight angle. So these are in tension, which is what this screw wants to do when the threads grab those studs. Between the friction along the facade and that tension through the screw, this is really stable. The exterior screws, they can go all the way through to the studs, but they don't have to. So this is what's primarily supporting the load that will translate from the brick cover through the horizontal battens.
The horizontals screw right into our vertical, and that's it. Like the weight is carried, like you said, on these vertical. What you're seeing on the end here is just kind of the end of our insulation layer. So we have a solid piece of blocking at any of our corners, our window bucks. We'll show you in a future episode how we're detailing the corners in terms of how they return back into the window. That was a question that came up quite a bit. Some of the other questions that came up is, well, how much does this weigh? These are about 13 pounds a piece. 36,000 pounds, if I did the math right, for the whole house. It is a heavy product, but none of this gets installed on a whim. This was a decision, Vincent, I think we made really early in the project. And when we're working with our consultants, our structural engineer, H&O, on this, they know that we're gonna have 36,000 pounds of brick in this house. It's not a, hey, let's decide on, you know, using something that is 5x as heavy as cedar would be. But you know, going back to the rain screen detail, you know, this is what's creating the longevity behind this system. Because if you look at the brick, there's no mortar, there's no maintenance.
Yeah, this can dry without, you know, the brick is a great material, and in a typical masonry wall, the weak point is its ability to dry. a correct way to build a masonry wall with mortar, of course. But in this case, you essentially have a masonry wall without the mortar. So the cladding can dry forever evenly and is, in the very long term, is probably going to last 500 years itself.
Sure.
The strapping that we used behind, it is pressure treated strapping. So it's going to be able to maintain, you know, handle moisture longer. But this is robust. I mean, this is a 75 to 100 year plus assembly. Ultimately, the decision to overbuild it in a way is an architectural one. There's performance, of course, in having this amount of exterior insulation, and there's architectural value to having this material that harkens heavy cedar shake and to masonry buildings at the same time. So to do something as unique as that required a more robust rain screen. But in terms of the building science behind it, you can really just think of it as any rain screen, but dialed up to handle this weight and format of the assembly.
Not only is it allowing the masonry to dry that can last 500 plus years, it's also allowing the wood to dry where you're not soaking this stuff and it's just sitting there sopping wet and over time deteriorating. It's giving the ability for that wood to get wet, which is protected by the pressure treated, but then dry, which increases the longevity behind the system itself.
Yeah, even when we are installing cedar cladding, for example, we try to do one by horizontal and vertical rain screen cavities so you get 3 inches of airspace. That's a lot more than it's the kind of maximum you'd possibly need. But the ability for that material to dry evenly in all directions is really the best way to handle ventilation in the rain screen. In subsequent site visits, as we look at the detailing around the window openings and the gutters and up the transitions up at the roof, making sure all this ventilates up so you don't have any pockets of moisture or heat accumulating is part of all the consideration that went into the detailing to make sure this generous rain screen can vent.
We have to think through those details. You have to think about how this ventilates all the way up through the top of the wall and ultimately at the top of the roof, because that's what creates the enduring product that we're after. In terms of the install for the shingles, you have these holes, and they actually cast a number of them, so as you cut them, you're not drilling any holes, but those holes are actually drilled on an angle. You can see on the back there, you know, they're at one distance here, but on the back they come down a bit. And what that does is, as you hang these and you install a screw, it's going down and hitting this top edge and then hitting your strapping. This is can be supported by gravity, but of course you're going to want 2 points tying it back to the wall, so it can't be peeled off of the wall. And then in a future episode, we're going to talk about our corner details, which this is a first peek at what we got going on. This is a metal fin detail. This is actually a piece of aluminum, but the final product will be a stainless steel fin, which will capture all of the corners, including the window returns. So if you guys are interested in building a house like this, please click the link below, schedule a 15-minute call, and we can talk about building your dream home.